Can you see my screen?
Yeah, looks great to me.
Wonderful. Just minimize this. Perfect. So hello, everyone. My name is Nathalie Moon, and I'm an assistant professor in the teaching stream in the Department of Statistics at the University of Toronto. And I've been at U of T for, well, this is my third academic year now, so since fall 2018. And in that time, I've taught two courses a number of times each, STAT 130 and STAT 490, that I'll tell you a little bit more about today. Both of these courses are unique in that they're very data focused, both of them. As you can tell from the numbers, one of them is at the first year level, the other one at the fourth year level. So covering similar topics, but at very different levels to very different audiences. So that's what I'll be commenting on today. So a little bit about my context. Again, the two courses I'm most familiar with at the University of Toronto are these two, STAT 130, Introduction to Statistical Reasoning and Data Science, and STAT 490, Statistical Consultation, Communication, and Collaboration. So STAT 130 is a course that is required for students who want to major in statistics. So they're not in our programs yet, but if they want to become in our programs, or if they want to enter our programs in second year, then they need to take this course. And the purpose of the course is to introduce students to big ideas in statistics and to give sort of context to the process of statistics and data science. And as a secondary, second, but not less important goal is to get students familiar with R and simulation-based inference, because that is something that has been identified as being really useful and sort of important in future statistics courses. Oh, I should mention as well, there's drilling in my building, so I really apologize if the sound is distracting. Please let me know if it becomes too much. I'm not sure there's much I can do, unfortunately, but I apologize for that. One thing to note about STAT 130 is that we don't assume that students come into the course with any programming knowledge or any experience with statistics. Some do have that experience, and that's certainly helpful in ways that they can support each other, but it's not assumed. In the fourth year course, on the other hand, these are senior students who are in one of our department's specialist programs. So these are students who've taken a lot of statistics courses. They're already familiar with R, and it's a course that sort of ties everything together. They've learned lots of statistics over the various courses they've taken, but they haven't put it all together and applied it to real problems on a larger scale. And that's what this course is for. So I'll tell you more about each of them coming up. But before I do that, here's a bit of context about the department more broadly. Our department has seen a lot of growth over the past 10 years or so. And so teaching data-focused topics is a really important priority, but over the past several years, and especially recently, that has been something we've had to do increasingly at scale, which is exciting but also challenging. So the programs in question, the fourth year course I've taught, it's the orange line, that's the programming question. So you can see it's grown quite a bit. And if we look at all students who want to major in our programs, the blue line, it's grown quite a lot as well. So demand for these courses has increased tremendously. So it's exciting in that students see the value of working with data and want more access to it and want to develop these skills. And part of our goal is to find a way to do that in a scalable and meaningful way. Oh, goodness, that's blurry. There we go. In STAT 130, given that our students aren't coming into the course with a common experience with programming and such, one of our big objectives is to reduce and eliminate barriers to getting started with R. So we don't assume that they come in with any prior knowledge. And one of the ways that we tried to make this as smooth a transition as possible to get everyone started is to use platforms like RStudio Cloud. That's what we've used over the past, two and a half years. And going forward, starting next term, we'll be using a Jupyter Hub, which is a sort of a U of T in-house solution. So it's a server where our studio installation on it. So we're hoping that the purpose of that is to avoid having the students install R locally, at least as their first exposure to R and R Studio. We hope that later as they progress, they may move to doing that themselves. But initially, we don't want them bogged down in technical installations and those kinds of things. We just want to get everyone started as quickly as possible. So as early as week one of the course, we want students to be in our studio independently knitting their first document. Usually we try to make it something exciting, like getting them to make a visualization really early, because that's always a fun boost. And for this course, First Tat 130, data really motivates all aspects of the course. So we have students telling stories with data. So a flow feel for that. We start with data visualizations because most people have some experience with that, but we formalize it a little bit more. Then we move on to data summaries. So how to construct them in R and how to interpret them. And then we move to data wrangling. Now you could argue that, you could argue with the order of these topics. I like doing data wrangling a little bit later just because doing data wrangling for data wrangling's sake is not maybe as exciting as other things you can do with data. So once you've got a little taste of what you can do with data using a tool like R, then it motivates students to want to do more and answer more interesting questions by manipulating the data in various ways, defining new variables and so on. Another sort of strain of the course is leading students or developing skills in terms of making data-supported conclusions about populations. So we have them thinking about hypothesis testing before we introduce the topic, and then we move along to simulation-based inference. So we don't cover the theory, the mathematical side of it. That's something that's covered in future statistics courses, but we use a simulation-based approach. And also we cover making predictions for new observations. So we start by covering how to build prediction models and then lead students to thinking about different limitations of various prediction approaches, either of the approaches or the data that's used to build the data in the first place. And in all of these topics, we also touch on ethics and data ethics. And that's something that Liza will talk more about, I believe, in her 10 minutes. So what can our students do at the end of a course like this? Well, the major project at the end of this course is a poster project, which in the past was done, was presented at a poster fair. So we would book a big space and everyone would come and present their posters, and it was very exciting and fun. Of course, with COVID, we've moved away from that. So students have been submitting slide decks instead. So we lose the social aspect, which is a shame. So I've given a few example prompts of the kinds of questions students have worked on in the past. So because of the size of the course, I didn't mention this. This is a class of, this year we had just under 550 students, all working with the same data, and that's for our own sanity. We give them a broad prompt, a broad topic, and the students are tasked with formalizing specific meaningful research questions and then addressing them. So addressing them using R to wrangle the data, create relevant visualizations, and conduct statistical analyses. They identify limitations with the data and such, and then they communicate the results to a target audience, specifically a non-statistical audience. So all of these elements are really at the core of the goals of the course, the students, based on what I've seen, what I've heard from them, are really proud of the work they've done on the projects. This was especially true in the in-person poster fair. And one question I always like to ask them is, at the beginning of the course, did you think you'd be able to do something like this when you first heard about this project that you'd have to do at the end of the term? And invariably, they they're surprised at what they were able to accomplish, because for many of them, it's their first exposure to programming, statistics, working with big data or big-ish data. So it's really amazing to see their progression. I'll just speak very briefly about 490 as well. So this course is also built around a major project. This is a full year course. So we have them from September to April, which gives them more time to go into more depth. So this major project is one where students are paired with non-statisticians, so researchers from a range of disciplines, and the students act as or serve as statistical consultants of sorts for these researchers. So, for example, this year we've got collaborators from the U of T libraries, from biology, from ecology, and oh, no, I'm forgetting who our other collaborators are, but from a range of disciplines across. Lab. What's that, Liza?
Politics lab on
politics
COVID
lab. Behavior. Yes, yes, yes. COVID data. How could I forget COVID data? So yes, we've got partners in a range of disciplines across the universities. So, of course, they're a key player in making this project a success. We also have a wonderful team of PhD student mentors who support the students in their work on these projects and serve as sort of a link between the students and the collaborators, and then the students themselves who are, of course, doing the statistical work. So the students meet with their project mentors and their collaborators outside of class time. We do have a time in the timetable for that. And then that leaves us with our official class time. So what do we do there? We discuss readings and case studies to support the students' success in their projects. So we talk about various aspects of exploratory data analysis, about written and oral communication of statistical results. And all of this is very, very focused on getting the, supporting the students through the process of going from first exposure to a new research problem to ultimately delivering a written report to the collaborator. So in summary, what does it mean in my context to work with real data? What are the strengths or the pros and the cons or challenges? Well, some of the pros, as I'm sure all of us have recognized, students really value the connection to real world problems. It grounds their learning in something that they know is useful and relevant outside of the class. And I find that it's a really nice way to motivate topics. So it takes less effort to convince them that something's important if you can point to a real example where you can use a particular technique with real data. Some of the challenges are good to acknowledge, but I think a very very workable. So the data is often big or big-ish. I'm not talking big data, but relatively big, and it's often messy. And that is a challenge in some contexts and a strength in others, of course. In particular, in the lower year courses, complicated data structures I find can be a challenge when you're trying to make a particular point and there's just a lot else going on and it's hard to streamline the attention on the point you're trying to make without getting distracted by everything else. So strategies I've taken to address both of this point in particular in both classes. Well, for the first year course, we know that they'll be with us, or we hope that they'll be with us for several years to come, so we can point to the courses in which they'll learn more about those things without being able to cover it all in this particular course. And for the fourth year course, in a sense, working with messy, complicated data is sort of the point. The goal is to prepare them for working with real data beyond their schoolwork, so we really aim to coach them and support them in developing these skills to learn independently how to handle this. So that's just a very quick overview of the two courses I'm most familiar with, and the similarities and differences in terms of how we handle learning with data. So I'll pass it over to Liza, who's also familiar with these two courses. I teach both of these courses with her, in fact, but she's got experience with some of the other courses at the University of Toronto as well.
Thanks so much, Nathalie. All right. So hopefully you can see my screen now. Awesome. So I've had the real pleasure to teach Stat 130 and Stat 490 with Nathalie and learn a lot from her in the process of that. And also just wanted to say hi before I get fully into it to a few of the Stat 490 family who are here. So I know Rika, Jerry, and Jaden, I saw you guys there, and I don't know who else is. They're some of our students. And we also have at least Maria and Michael, who are our TAs. And also hello to Amin, who's going to be one of my 303 TAs, my head TA, and to Nena, who's one of my 303 TAs. So thanks for coming out. I hope I don't scare you off with mine. I think Nathalie did a good job of talking about some of the things we do. I was telling Rohan, I had a burst of inspiration during our department meditation class today, which is why you're getting what you're about to get. So I had fun making it. Let's see if you guys have fun coming on this journey with me. So I love teaching data-focused topics, and I made you guys a mixtape to woo you into being my statistically significant others when it comes to being on this journey of data-focused teaching together. So drop my mixtape in the chat if you guys want to see the songs that I'm gonna make today be about.
It's Liza with a Z, not Lisa with an S, cause Lisa with an S goes snuds. It's Z instead of S, Lie instead of Lee. It's simple as can be, see Liza.
All right, so hopefully you can hear that. No worries if not, but my name is Liza. Much like Liza Minnelli, I have problems with people pronouncing it. I was born in Canada, but I have spent half my life living in New Zealand. So if I say anything weird, assume it's just totally normal Canadian or New Zealand slang and not just a peculiarity of my, you know, being. I'm very much a person who's interested in applied data, and I tell people I got into statistics because I'm just really nosy. Like, I want to know how things work. I want to know how people work. I want to know how stuff works. And so that's why I'm a statistician. And I also have some experience I bring to this role from being, I sort of accidentally started my own statistical consultancy while I was doing my PhD in New Zealand. And I got to work with a lot of really small clients who could like afford me because I wasn't very expensive because I was a beginner. And I got to work on really cool projects that didn't really always require that much fancy statistical ability, required some and thinking well, but just things about being more comfortable with data, being able to communicate well, and being able to deal with just some of the messy stuff that happens when you have real people data. And I try to bring that to a lot of my teaching because it's what I've really seen actually affect people's, you know, bottom line in the actual sense of money in terms of clients I've worked with. So that's part of sort of the philosophy that I bring. And one of those things is reproducibility, which I've just put in the chat, a plug for the Toronto Data Workshop reproducibility series coming in February. Hopefully I got the right link, Rohan, but he could fix it if I was wrong. So what I want to talk to you with this time, and I haven't actually looked at when I started, so I should try to be quicker, is a little bit about what I'm currently doing, a lot about what I wish I was doing better and sort of what my 2021 resolutions are. Hopefully just taking you along for a little bit of that journey. Okay, next, oops. Okay, good. I tried to keep them all short. So I'm going to pitch Stat 303 to you. The way I'm planning to pitch it to my students, if I get around to making the trailer for the course that I've had in my mind, I've got like a storyboard out, and it's going to start with like, you know, movie trailer voiceover voice, like in a world where data are everywhere. And that's how it's going to start. And then it's going to go to basically a Star Trek cover where it's like one of the ensigns coming in and being like, Captain, our independence assumption has been totally violated by the repeated measures. What do we do? And then someone else comes in and goes, the response, Captain, the response, it's all binary. And then at the end, me, because of course I'm playing all the characters, comes in with massive Janeway hair. You can tell there's a Trekkie over here. And then basically the line is like, we have to go beyond. And we're going beyond linear regression because we are doing a bunch of other different methods. And so this course, I taught for the first time last winter. I'm teaching it for the second time this coming winter. I will have 600 students across two sections. Sort of similar numbers to what Nathalie and I have for 130, but Nathalie and I have a team of 24 TAs for 130, and I have a team of 6 or 7 TAs when I teach 303. So in terms of the ways you can support writing and the ways that you can support more tailored feedback, I'm still figuring out how to do that without blowing my TA budget because maybe COVID kind of saved me in winter with the amount of marking I was going to end up having to do myself. But this course, changes I'm wanting to make to it will involve, well, some of the things that I'm about to show you.
Immanuel Kant was a real piss and he was very rarely stable. Heidegger was a boozy beggar who could think you under the table. David Hume could out-consume Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel. And Wittgenstein was a beery swine who was just a schloss to schlegel.
So my favorite time sort of feeling like called out at a dinner was when we were interviewing for one of the cross appointments between the Department of Statistics and the Department of Philosophy, which is, oh my gosh, so my jam. What a cool role. I'm not a philosopher, but I want to know more. And I'm really happy we recruited for this. But I always have my teaching data hat on. And so I asked one of the interviewees what they thought was coming from a philosophy background, what they thought statisticians should be doing really differently in how they teach ethics. And what he very kindly said was, well, don't just make it 1 week in week 12 where you're like, this is ethics week and then we're moving on. As I have like my syllabus in my heart where week 12 is literally ethics week. And that's when we talk about it and we really enjoy talking about it. And at least it's there, but yeah, no, it's not really integrated in a lot of the other things. So I'm gonna try teaching ethics week 2 or something like that when I do 303 this time. And I wanna make sure that I'm putting myself in a good position to call back to it throughout with our different data sets, as opposed to go, and now it's ethics weeks. You know that stuff we did before? Maybe dodgy, maybe not, who's to say? So this is something I'm really hoping to do differently in my own practice.
Spider-Man, friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. Is he strong? Listen, bud, he's got radioactive blood. Hey there.
Okay, so one example of how I'm doing this and how we've already started doing things a little differently in Stat 130 and Stat 490 is using web scraping and APIs as one of these gateways to both getting data and working with data. Because I think having a concept of how data is got or how data is produced is really important to them being able to work with it well. And something that a lot of students don't get to experience. They have this very static final object called assignment to data. And that's all they sort of know how to work with it for. I know it's a bit of a stretch for this mixtape song, but how often do I get to like make a whole bunch of people listen to Canadian 90s comedy bands sing about Spider-Man? So web, Spider-Man, stuff like that. I do have on my GitHub what we did with our fourth years, if anyone's interested in looking at that. And one thing I think we can really add as a point of difference as instructors is, sure, if a student wants to go learn web scraping, there are a bajillion Medium articles from everyone on how to do it in Beautiful Soup or R or whatever you want. I have yet to find one without specifically searching for the ethics of web scraping that does a good job of discussing the ethics of web scraping. And there's some very basic rules about being more polite and conscientious that are great to introduce to students, totally accessible to a first year. We taught it in Stat 130 this semester, but we also got to do it more in the actual practice with our 490 students. And it's a great time to introduce, if students aren't aware of for loops, you can use for loops. But I have really been enjoying teaching the map set of functions from PER, because that's how you get your code looking really sexy when you're ready to move on from for loops. And Sam in the chat as well. Rohan did an amazing workshop on APIs and ethics and things like that for us for our summer community that I'll talk a little bit at the end. Now, this just briefly is something I want to do better. I don't actually think my students are vain, or certainly not any more vain than humans are in general. But in that spirit of how we get data and sitting with the frustrations of dealing with humans imperfectly answering your questions when you're trying to collect their data, I think it'd be a really insightful and sort of eye-opening experience for students.
Never mind, I'll find someone like you.
I'm hoping to do in 303 and 490 more is once students start having some of the scripts for how to approach their data, it can be really hard to then start being more flexible, right? And so something that you really see this in is missing data, because suddenly the missing data isn't just one or two rows the prof forgot to delete. It's really fundamental to what you tell your collaborator. So we have, I know some folks from 490 here where they have a lot of like missing data about their turtles or about their fish locations. And that's really hard to then deal with. And I think giving people more tools and flexibility to think about how to tailor how they deal with missing data for their circumstances is really important. So whether it's finding someone like you with imputation, or hey, somehow you can just delete all the missings, that's not usually the answer as often as we might wish it would be. So I want to get more of this in my data, or in the examples I give in class, and also spend time really focusing on the philosophies behind different ways of approaching it, or like why you would do this for what situation.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird.
And the other thing I want to want to do more of, and I know I'm speaking to a group where there's a lot of people who do really, really cool stuff with text. I want to get some really basic tech stuff in my 303 course, because it's something I've heard from employers when, once again, always wearing my teaching hat, and every time I like host an alumni panel or like talk to a real person, it's like, so what do you wish students knew? Because I'll just go teach them that. Tell me what you want. And text data comes up a lot. So doing some really simple regular expressions has saved my butt so many times with clients for just messy survey data that I'm looking for ways to get little bits of that into my teaching and not have it be the main focus, because I know there's a lot of complicated methods out there that are outside of my wheelhouse. But even just getting the ideas of text as data is something that I don't think some of our students have come across. And I'm really excited about opening up the world of what data could be to more people.
Can we just talk?
I wanted to end on something else that I did over the summer and that Nathalie and I are continuing to work on that I think is a really fun, like the opposite of teaching. Well, it's the true spirit of teaching data focused topics, but without having to give anyone grades. And so we ran really ad hoc and at the last moment, a summer program for our students that was completely online, hosted through Slack, doing workshops and social events, because COVID sucks, everyone was scared and lonely. And I read this really scary New York Times article about economic scarring and how students graduating in a pandemic like might never recover to the levels of their peers who graduated before. So sufficiently spooked, a team of us tried to put something together that was not a course. It was a way to work on data projects, build your portfolio, explore your career options, and how to focus on personal development as well. And so one thing I did kind of not intentionally, I just did it one week and then kept doing it for about a month and a half, is these little tidy Tuesday and talk hangouts on a Tuesday afternoon. And they'd usually be an hour or two. And if you're not familiar with Tidy Tuesday, I would definitely like have a look at that whole community. It's really awesome. Great source of data for teaching. Nathalie and I use it quite a lot. It's in connection with the Hadley Wickham R for Data Science book, which is also an absolute gem. And it was really fun because I hadn't really had a look at the data beforehand. I sometimes had sort of generally picked a topic, like I taught them reproducible slides in SharonGAN really quickly one week. We looked at color palettes in another week and just did some sort of just whatever I sort of had on my mind. And then sometimes I had no idea about the data set. So I got educated about Animal Crossing. Students were happy to tell me about it. Got educated about beach volleyball. I had an expert in that. And it's a really great opportunity. Another more general reason why real data is fabulous in your classroom is because you can then draw on students' own expertise. They won't all be experts in everything, but you may have moments where people can actually take real ownership because they have expertise in relationship to the data. And then they can be an ambassador for why this might be, or why might this be missing, or what does this mean? And as a plug for that, sorry, I had a couple links. I put most of them in, but I forgot one of my earlier plugs, but that's okay. It's too big. But Nathalie and I tomorrow are talking about this as part of our Arts and Science, University of Toronto Teaching and Learning community of practice. If you want to hear us talk more about like, what do you do with 700 students over the summer who say, yes, they'd like to come on a data adventure with you. Now you have to do programming for like 2 months worth of stuff and write newsletters because you said you would. That was a fun journey and also very data focused if this is your jam. Like most of the times I have thoughts or do a talk, someone else has tweeted it in one tweet better than I ever could. This is really what I was trying to say to y'all. So kudos to Michael for this excellent tweet. I'm sorry I did not look at the time, Rohan. I know that's a really naughty speaker, but I hope you guys enjoyed some musical choices. And I would really, really love to hear from you about any of the thoughts you have on this, especially for the things I'm trying to do better. If you have things you want to share, I would love to hear them. Love Twitter, hit me up on there, or feel free to email me at any time. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Liza. Our next guest is Maria Tackett, who's joining us from Duke University. Maria is in the stats department there, and has a PhD in stats from University of Virginia as well. So thank you very much, Maria.
Here we go. Yeah, thanks for having me. Unfortunately, I don't have music. I didn't think of it. That was so fun. Oh man. Also too, it's not apparent that I'm from the US. Earlier I told a group of people in talking that it was 40 degrees here, and I realized that would mean it's extremely hot when you convert that to Celsius. There you go. But yeah, in thinking about what I wanted to talk about today, one of the things that's just been on my mind a lot is rethinking lectures. And I think with COVID and a lot of people having to transition to online, I know for me in particular, my lectures is what have changed the most. And so one of the things I've been thinking about is how can I take a lot of the changes I've had to make this semester from COVID and actually maybe even carry that into, well, next semester when I'm teaching online again, but then also in the future, even like back in the physical classroom. And so that's just, I'll just kind of share some thoughts that I have about that today. So just to give you some backing on the class that I'm thinking about, it's an intro to data science class. So I mostly teach our undergraduate courses, our sort of intro level and intermediate level courses. And so the class I'm thinking about in particular right now is our intro to data science class. This is basically an alternative to like an intro statistics class. So we get students from all majors, all sorts of interest background. There's no prerequisite for the class. So these are students who are mostly learning statistics as well as computing for the first time, though we do have different levels of previous knowledge just because a lot of students now are getting some of that in high school as well. So this semester I had 90 students, which I thought was large until I heard 550. So I don't know, maybe this is about a small class. But the general structure is we have two lectures each week, as well as a lab where students get to do a lot of hands-on things. And so I'll focus mostly on just what I've been thinking about in terms of lectures. And then also just to give you some more background on the class, a lot of the sort of philosophy and topics that are taught are really similar to the ones that Nathalie described in the Stat 130. So you could kind of keep that class in mind. But a lot of it has been based off of Mina Chintan-Kaur-Rendell's Data Science in a Box curriculum. So if you're getting started in teaching data science, I recommend, I think the website's just datascienceinabox.org. She has great materials and then also just really good information about the philosophy and sort of the method to the madness there. So a lot of the things we do is based off of that curriculum. And so in that vein, the students are using R, we teach R tidyverse in particular, and then we also use GitHub. So students are submitting their assignments through GitHub and using that regularly, starting from really the first day of class, especially this semester, since we needed a way to actually get their materials. But that's just sort of a background on the course that I'm thinking about. And so as Rohan mentioned, I come from like a traditional stat background. My undergrad degree was actually in math, and then I got my master's and PhD in statistics. So I come from like a really traditional background. And so one of the things I've been thinking about a lot in conversations with different people and in just thinking about like how to teach a data science class is the relationship between statistical content and computing. And so the way I was trained, and I think the way I've kind of thought about the relationship between the two, right, is that the statistical concepts are sort of the main event, and we teach the computing as a way to facilitate getting to the actual stuff we want to get to, which is the statistics. So that's really a traditional approach. But in thinking about how to teach these more data-driven courses, I think there's actually a balance between the two, where now the computing is not actually sort of like, how do we get to the statistics? The computing is the content of the course itself. And so one of the things I've been thinking a lot about as an instructor is, how do I find that balance between the statistical content and the computing? Because at the end of the day, this is a statistics class, but this is also a data science course. And so we want students to deal with a lot of that data that, you know, like Liza mentioned, like text data, or that really messy, interesting data where you need that good computing foundation in order to do that. And so I think there's a lot of ways you approach this, right, and how you think about the topics you cover, how you assess students and everything, but I'll sort of focus on how I've thought about restructuring my lectures, in particular, sort of thinking about the tension between these two. And so this semester, again, I taught online, and so my lectures were broken up into two components, what I called the lecture content videos, and then also the live lecture session. And so the idea of the lecture content videos, right, this is, it's basically like a version of a flipped classroom, if you've heard of that. The lecture content videos were where students really got the statistical concept, so that was primarily the focus of those videos. Students would watch those before they came to class, again, to sort of just get the definitions and kind of the foundational stuff. But also through those videos, they were getting exposure to the code. So, you know, not only would they like see a scatter plot, they would also see the code that created that scatter plot. And so then we had our live lecture session. So this is when we all met. Generally there'd be about 70 or so students on there. So a good size amount of students on Zoom. And this is where we were really focusing on the computing as well as the application. So we started out with like a Q&A where students could ask questions from the videos. And then also would do like a short demo, and then students could really sort of put the two together and apply what they've learned on some practice problems. So then in just sort of thinking about like things that went well and things that I could do better next time. So things that worked well, we're having like the live coding demos followed by the small group activities in Zoom. So part of what drove me to the more flipped classroom format is that it's really difficult for students to listen to someone lecture for an hour on Zoom. And so I wanted to make the synchronous part, the live part, as interactive as possible. And so I think it worked out fairly well doing just like a, where I would sort of do a live coding demo, getting to sort of the more computing aspects, like how do we deal with these messy data? How do we deal with different data types? That sort of thing, the things that weren't necessarily in the videos. And then students would work in small groups where they would put together the statistical content with the computing to do some like kind of sort of small case study things. One thing I did find with the live coding is that generally the way this works, students would basically watch me do the coding just because we're on Zoom. And so a lot of students found it difficult to navigate, you know, an RStudio screen as well as the Zoom screen. But I could imagine when this is in a physical classroom again, students could be doing the coding along with you, with the instructor. And then also another thing I loved, which I actually got this idea from Greg Wilson, who I think is on the call, is having someone in the class to help answer questions. And this saved my life during the semester. So I had a TA in the class with me, and he would answer, and he would basically kind of run the chat. And the chat was fairly active, like the chat is here. And this was great because the students had weird error messages, or they're like, hey, I want to change the color of this plot, but I don't know where. You know, you could get that more in-depth conversation kind of going in the chat without derailing from the sort of big conversation that I was having with the class. And then just to kind of wrap up with some things that I want to think about doing better next time. So I started out with this idea that in these classes, the computing is the content. And I realized that by just sort of exposing students to code, but then sort of moving the computing, the live coding to the live lectures, I'm not sure I fully got that point across. And so I noticed just from comments from students at the end of the semester, or just throughout the semester, that they weren't fully grasping that this is actually really important. And so I think including actual, like me on an RStudio screen, like live coding as part of here's the content for the course, not only makes it easier for students to get that content, because sometimes it's hard to scroll through the recording of the live lecture session, but again, it also reinforces that point that no good computing habits are actually part of the content of this course. And then not really specific to teaching a data-driven course, but just like a teaching thing, right? Just having more accountability for those videos. So, right, the idea of a flipped classroom, it works best when students are coming in prepared. And so students would get participation points for finishing the activities, but I didn't have, mostly just as the idea of I didn't want to put pressure on students, but no sort of real accountability besides maybe just like not being embarrassed in front of your teammates, no real accountability for watching the videos. And so, it was apparent at times, right, when students weren't watching the videos, just based off some of the questions they were answering. And so thinking about ways to incorporate light accountability, maybe through one thing I did try later in the semester, which I enjoyed, which I'll do more often next semester, is we actually did some text analysis, and I had lyrics to Gettin' Jiggy With It by Will Smith in there. And so I just said in the video, if you email me the name of the song and the artist, you know, you get a bonus point or something. So just kind of thinking of small ways to encourage students lightly without putting a lot of administrative grading burden on me and also not too much pressure on them. But yeah, that's really all that I have. Just wanted to share some things I've been thinking about. I would love to hear what other people are thinking about as far as lectures. And then here's my email and a way to find me on Twitter. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Maria. I suspect that maybe the students were like, who's Will Smith? Why are you having us? Jaden's dad used to rap or something? It's very upsetting. You age and the students remain the same age. Anyway, our next guest is Teon Brooks, who has a PhD in psychology from NYU, but is actually a data scientist at Mozilla. So very much looking forward to Teon.
Yes. So today I'm going to be a bit of a maverick. I did not come with slides, so I'm going to just talk to you all. So there's just like four key points that I want to talk through, and then we can just dive directly into the panel discussion. So I'll just keep my remarks a bit brief. So yeah, my background is in psychology. In undergrad, I studied linguistics and psychology. And my PhD program, I studied cognition perception within experimental psychology. And my focus was on understanding language and how does the brain understand reading. So one of the biggest things that I've been interested in as a psychologist and as an experimentalist is like, how do we understand humans? How do we understand what humans do? And how do we understand how do we think? And this is part of an overarching theme that I have now with like how I'm tying this into data science, which I'll go into deeper toward the end of it. It's like combining cognitive science and data science into this realm of understanding computations in humans and machines. So this was a theme that was part of the Cognitive Science Society this past year, where they were actually interested in what would cognition be in a machine and understanding like cognition in humans. And this year they're doing comparative cognition, so they're going to be looking at animals. So it's just like a broader theme. It's like, how do we understand what it is to think? So as I progress in my career, one of the things that I've been focused on a lot has been teaching, and I've done teaching through many different avenues. A lot of it has come through the open source community. So I got my first bearings into programming actually on GitHub. I had to learn how Git worked. I had to learn how merge conflicts worked, which is a bit frustrating. And it was just a very interesting learning experience to gain skills in like how to program in Python, how to collaborate with other people virtually online, which kind of just sets the stage for like how we're all like working online these days. So these are some key aspects of like how I go about like teaching and how I incorporate into classes. So one of the things that I focused on most recently was the RStudio certified training program that is that Greg Wilson invited me to be a participant in, and it was fantastic. I have had experience with R. My primary programming language is Python, but I really wanted to expand the type of tools that I would be able to teach both at work and also in other settings. So I forced myself to learn how to teach R, so it got me to learn R myself. So I wanted to give myself a structured way to learn the skills, and the best way is to have it in a program. So this has been great because now what I can do is put, like when presenting like different data analysis practices to learners, what I can do is show them, say, this is how the R philosophy and R studio philosophy and just like the tidyverse like philosophy is around like data analysis. And this is just like one flavor of the way that you can do data analysis. Another flavor of data analysis would be in the Python stack where you use pandas and you can use scikit-learn or stats model. So it's to show like there's no one way to do data science. There's a plurality of way of doing data science. So I think that's like also a great thing to show students that if they come up with a different solution, it doesn't mean that they did anything wrong. Let's just walk through the process to how they got there. So the RStudio training was super great so that I got this ability so I can now teach students both how to do R and with the backing of RStudio and using Hadley Wilkins' book and the great education staff at RStudio to like help me master the skill of the tidyverse. We've taught workshops before. We were down in Atlanta last year, pre-COVID times, and we had a workshop where we taught like intro to the tidyverse. And that was a great opportunity to just like put these skills into motion and actually work with students both as the lecturer and also hands-on at the at their desks. And it's always a great philosophy to have, as Greg Wilson pointed out, a driver and a navigator in the classroom, because it allows for both people to excel and to move the class toward the shared goal of like learning a new skill. And we're able to like both keep your eyes on the road and navigate us toward that destination. So largely, workshops have been a good way for me to constantly keep abreast of like where students are and when they're learning, and also where things are in industry where I actually apply it to my work. So I work at Mozilla, and it's the maker of Firefox. And one of the things that we've been focused on in the past like 3 years since I've started there is like, how do we teach data intuition, data skills throughout the company so that we could make informed decisions about product, around business direction, so that we have mechanisms to check our assumptions on things. And it's just been great, but we've had to bootstrap all of this. So it's been a great learning experience. One of the things I took from the RStudio training is that we wanted to run workshops for our user researchers. So how it works at Mozilla is that we have data scientists who tend to work a lot with product to understand like user behavior. So like how many times does someone use the address bar? And do we need to improve the experience of the address bar? I know the address bar because that's the product that I work on. And we often have like user researchers who do in-person interviews. They also do survey panels. They use a variety of mixed methods to understand how users are interacting with the product. And we get to see how users interact at the large scale of like everyone who's using Firefox. So we wanted to do Skillshare, and one of the things is that we wanted to give them a taste of like how the data science workflow works at Mozilla. So I led the same workshop that I did with the RStudio workshop we taught in Atlanta among like our user researchers. And this was really neat. We actually did it virtually over Zoom, and this was pre-COVID. So it was all setting up the stage for like how to run workshops virtually. And it was very great that we had this iterative process of learning where they are skill-wise and being able to adapt the coursework to it. So that's one of the most important things I found, is trying to level set both my expectations and their expectations of like where we are and where we would like to go. And we can have the course that's very adaptable to it. So I take a module approach. So I have like nuggets of information that I like to put together and reconfigure it as the class progresses so that you can go faster or dial it back a bit and have an opportunity to make sure that we're all moving in the same direction. So that was one of the things I've done internally with some of our trainings, and we've started a second iteration that's going to happen this winter. And then we're going to do a Python variety flavor of this as well. And we will be showing that among our data, among the data scientists on our team, there's a split of Python users and R users, and we all work together on the same data set. And we can show this is how, even within our team, there's not one way to do it. So it shows in the company there are opportunities to try different approaches, and we have a shared reference of the data. So that's been really neat, and we're building out this course material internally so that we can have these modules. I recorded the videos. I have to go through and watch myself on video, which is always an experience, I would say. So we have this, and it allows for me to iterate on my course materials and provide a new approach to things that may have stumped me the first time that it happened. And all together, I will be actually teaching in an academic setting this coming spring. I will be teaching a statistical programming class at American University. And this will be a way for me to both bridge the industry skills that I have and go back into an academic setting that I haven't been in a few years. So it'll be really nice to be among a university and have like a break from my a typical 9 to 5 and get to see like where are students at these days and show where we are in the field of data science and industry. And one last thing that I'll tie in is that I started a nonprofit in like 2 years ago, a year ago. So we're 1 year old now. So 2020 has been a very, very long year. It has felt longer than one. So with the nonprofit, our focus is actually on this concept of blending cognitive science and data science together. So we're actually working right now on a concept book called Computation in Humans and Machine, Understanding this Process. And one of the things that we would like to develop is like both the course material, have it all open source, and then also use some of the tools that have been developed out of our studio. Greg Wilson has worked on the Tidy Blocks project, and I very much admire it. And one of the things we want to be able to do is use that as the building blocks for this course we want to teach with this book on, say, how would you, how might a science journalist evaluate a research article for whether it's true or not. So we want to give like expert opinions of like what we go through to verify if a scientific article is like robust in its findings and worthy of communicating. And we would also like to show how would you say train a classifier to say whether this is a news article like a scientific article worthy of sharing or something that should be left where it currently is. So the neat thing we will want to do is say start with the data, do some descriptive statistics on there, say know the number of words that are in the sentence, to know the number of times a word appeared in the sentence, and use like these blocks as the way to go through this understanding, and then build a simple classifier that will show why it doesn't work. But it could just be a simple logistic regression and show like we can decide whether it's a scientific article worthy of sharing or not, and then go through both the ethics behind it. So if what are the things that we need to consider is like, how many articles are you training this on? What type of information are you deciding on? What are all of these features? And give this an opportunity to have a way to engage with the student on both like how experts in the field are doing this, how the machine would do it, and what does it mean for a machine to make these decisions? And then try to have this as a book that anyone can use. And it's very much a work in progress. I'll drop a link in the chat, but we are trying it out and look for collaborations, and that's all I will leave it for now.
Thank you very much, Teon. We are at 5, so what I might do is just say thank you very much to our panelists in case folks need to head off. I will also say thank you very much to everyone who has participated over the course of the term. This is our final meeting. We will start back on the 14th of January at 4:30. We have a full slate of weekly speakers, including, of course, people from Toronto, people from Uber, people from our studio. We're going to launch a DOS toolkit, which is all sorts of essentials for dealing with R. We're going to have a whole workshop on reproducibility. I can keep going, but we're out of time. And so I will send a link about this. I'll send an email as usual next week, and so we'll get all the details there. So if you do need to head off, then thank you very much for a wonderful term and hope to see you next. If the panelists are able to hang around, I mean, if you can't, then that's can't, but I feel like we're all just uber teaching nerds. And so if you are able to hang around, then we should just keep, maybe we can have a bit of a internal discussion initially, and then maybe we could bring it out to some, open it up to some other questions from the panel. I would just start by saying, Maria and Teon, we are growing and that means we're hiring. I'm not sure if our current jobs have closed, but if they have closed, they may have just closed, but we're always hiring teaching stream folks. I would imagine there'll be more. So please don't be a stranger.